What's up, everybody? Welcome to Sit Down. I'm DJ Sixsmith, hanging out with Helena York, actress. How are you?
Hi, good to meet you.
Good to meet you, too. Thank you for coming in today.
Please, thank you for having me.
So you got your new show, The Other Two, comes out on Thursday, January 24th,
yeah.
But you have a pretty interesting career, interesting life, so
yeah.
Let's unpack that a little bit here. Take me all the way back and, you know, what inspired you to get into this whole crazy business?
I started dancing at the age of 3. Was really my, you know, intro drug, I guess.
You did ballet, right?
I did ballet, yeah. And I danced a little bit on the show, which was really fun and random treat. So I got into it through dance, and then, you know, was performing as I was growing up. And I went to school at the University of Michigan for musical theater. Packed up the back of my friend's car, drove to Astoria, Queens, and started making a slog at it. And, you know, worked a coat check at Reebok Sports Club on the Upper West Side, did a couple off-Broadway shows, toured, and then thought, you know, maybe I should try this television thing.
Yeah.
That seems cool. And now I'm, you know, working with two of the, you know, premier voices of comedy of our generation on a show for Comedy Central. It's been wild.
It's quite an arc when
yeah.
you think about it that way.
Yeah.
So we were talking off camera. If you had gone to school in New York, you could have been seduced by everything going on around
you.
Oh
my
York.
God. Any of my friends, you went to school at Florida,
right.
My friends that went to NYU, and I just think, oh my God, I mean, how to be focused on what you're doing, but to have so much of what's out there in front of you all the time.
Yeah, it's hard
I
to
really
keep
had to,
attention.
Yeah, I had to lock myself in an overheated room in Ann Arbor in order to like really get something done as far as learning went.
Definitely. So
yeah.
When you think about your experience at the University of Michigan, what sticks out the most to you when you look back?
I look back and the people that I went to school with are really extraordinary. Benj Pasek and Justin Paul were in my graduating class. They wrote the music for Dear Evan Hansen.
Yep.
And
Justin Paul went to my high school.
You're kidding!
Yeah, he graduated way before me. But
I was at his wedding.
Wow.
That was years ago. You probably weren't
right.
there.
No, nope, definitely was not there.
Yeah, so I went to school with them, and my friend Jake Wilson now writes for television, directs music videos.
Nice.
Andrew Keenan Bolger, he's a great actor and talent, and just being around people that were into what I was into.
Yeah.
I got there and immediately just thought, oh, everybody's as weird as I am. This is fantastic.
So when did you become like a theater nerd, entertainment nerd? Like how early in age? Because you were doing the ballet thing, but when does it really start to
yeah.
pick up steam there?
My dad, when I was 16, took me to see The Producers on Broadway at the St. James
one.
Theater.
Yep.
And, you know, that was Susan Stroman's collaboration with Mel Brooks at the time, and I just thought, God, this is amazing. And I saw, then I also went to go see Sutton Foster in Thoroughly Modern Millie.
Yep.
And if I see Sutton Foster sometimes, like out in the world, and recently I was doing a show at City Center Encores. I was doing Grand Hotel, and she came, and I hid in my dressing room from her because I was like, I can't meet her. She can't. I'm gonna freak out. And she's gonna know that I love her, and it's too much. And nothing puts stars in my eyes more still than somebody who's a big deal in theater.
Yeah.
And you go to school and you learn all the ins and outs of it, and God, if somebody gets me going, I won't stop talking about theater.
Well, the theater thing has been such a huge part of your life,
yeah.
your career, and I love talking about the theater with actors and actresses because it helps you in so many different ways.
Yeah.
So how has it impacted your career to this day? What are the biggest things that you've been able to do with it?
I think what theater teaches you so much is a collaborative environment. When you put a show together, you're locked in a room for 4 to 6 weeks,
right.
like bleeding and sweating, literally, with, you
getting
know.
Sick of the people that you're with.
Yeah, well, yeah. trying not to, but
right.
mostly having fun
yeah.
and building something and playing off one another. And that kind of collaborative spirit is something that is so fun to bring to television, especially in the space of doing a comedy, which is what The Other Two is that there's a real sense of play and to be open to having things thrown at you and, you know, reacting in a certain way. And theater really teaches you that. It kind of brushes off your inhibitions in a way that really gets you feeling free. And it's been really nice to have that background going into television.
Definitely. And you mentioned this concept of playing, and it's
yeah.
just like an actor's dream to be able to do that.
Yeah.
So you had it on the stage. How cool is it to do it in a TV show? Really, a show that you can kind of fully show all of your talents off.
Yeah, I mean, I got to play with Drew Tarver, who plays my brother,
yeah.
is a seasoned, incredible improviser. If you're ever in Los Angeles, you should go see his team at UCB.
Mm.
He's unbelievably good. And then Ken Marino, who is notoriously a wonderful improviser, and, you know, Molly Shannon and Wanda Sykes and all these incredible people on the show. And so to be playing, tossing the ball with people, as it were, right. with people that skilled is, you know, it just gets tossed back to you, and going back and forth, it's just an extra added boost because, God, who doesn't want to play catch with Molly Shannon?
I think that's a good person to play catch with.
Yeah.
It's somebody that's definitely seasoned in that category.
Exactly.
As well.
Definitely, you know,
just
she's done
bit,
some things,
right?
Yeah.
So this TV show is obviously different from stuff in the past, but what were the biggest differences and maybe some of the challenges that you encountered along the way?
You know, I think Chris Kelly and Sarah yep. Schneider, who created the show, they were co-head writers at SNL, and they wanted to create their own thing, and their voice is so smart and so kind and so positive.
Right.
And so while being incredibly funny and putting their characters in these wild situations, you know, we have this brother that's becoming this mega superstar, and there's no animosity, there's, you know, I think that we want to rise to the occasion. We're kind of thinking, oh, you know, how do we take advantage of yeah. this, you know, steam train that's happening? But more than anything, they support one another. And overwhelmingly, what's been so nice to hear from people who have seen the show is how unexpected it was that it was a sibling comedy that didn't have that kind of, you know, competitive or negative take. Because it would be really easy, for example, to make fun of the Chase Dreams character.
Absolutely.
But
yeah.
he's so loving and so proud of his hot mess older brother and sister.
And so innocent as a younger kid.
Yeah,
too.
And God bless him. And Case Walker in real life yeah. is exactly that way. And it's just being raised to be a wonderful young man. And I think that shows on screen, and it's what makes it different, I think.
That's awesome. And people usually don't focus on the siblings of stars either. You know, it's just kind of like the add-on. You think
yeah.
of the Jonas Brothers, and it's like, oh, yeah, there's the bonus Jonas. It's just, who is that guy, right?
A bonus Jonas. Do they have a bonus Jonas?
They do have a bonus Jonas. I mean,
funny.
It's been a long time since I thought about the bonus Jonas.
I think what it is that it's like, you know, we all have to measure ourselves up against what's happening in our faces on social media
right.
all the time. But imagine if a much younger sibling became so much more successful than
yeah.
you overnight. How do you grapple with that?
And then your parents are totally focused on that person
yeah.
and not you. Yeah.
And do I take advantage of this? Do I ride a coattail in some way? How do I find my own identity
right.
and confidence within whatever that is? Even Case, who we read with when he auditioned for the show to play Chase, you know, he, after got it, he was like, oh yeah, that was my first audition. And
wow.
me and Drew were like, uh-huh. We were scraping dollars together, and you just, here you are. And it's incredible. It's a different way of catapulting, for
yeah.
sure.
It's really fascinating when it hits for certain people, because you have that example, which is
yeah.
immediate right away.
Yeah.
Somebody like you, you pack everything up, you get to Astoria, and it's a much longer journey.
Yeah, and you're like, how much does an egg and cheese sandwich cost? Do
seriously.
I just scramble eggs every, like,
yeah.
what do I do?
Right. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I gotta have these ramen noodles every single night.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
So, speaking of those days, take me back. You know, what was the most jarring thing about those initial days? Because you're working at Reebok, you're doing these shows, you're just literally trying to survive.
You know, you're doing 3 auditions a day, and if you live in New York City, you know, you just become a pack mule.
Yep.
So, you know, you audition for 3 different things, you've got different outfits, you're changing in a Starbucks bathroom sometimes, trying to get it together. And I just remember sometimes being on the train with regular commuters going to 9-to-5s with jobs
yeah.
and contributing to their 401ks and just thinking, oh my God, that must be so nice to have a regular place to go
stability.
Every day.
Yep.
And now to feel so fortunate that I have, you know, opportunities to have this dynamic, incredible life doing what I do.
Yeah.
But I would say that's the hardest is, you know, the weight of, literally the weight of what you carry around the city trying to make it happen. And, you know, basically asking every room to love you.
Right.
It's tough. And, you know, to have it start to happen, like, I was driving around Los Angeles. I'm from LA originally. And, you know, my mom would drive me around to my dance classes and voice lessons. And I was just in LA, and I looked up, and I'm on a billboard
wow.
in Los Angeles. And you just think, God, I don't want to be cliche, but, you know, dreams come true.
Yeah, no, it's amazing
it's
when
crazy.
You put it in that context. Little girl going to voice lessons, having no idea what your career
yeah.
is going to be. And then here you are, big show.
I know. I feel like the next thing is when I'm defaced in the New York City subway is when I'll really know.
That's when you've really made it in this
I've
city.
I've really made it.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So you did the whole Broadway thing for a long time.
I did the Broadway thing. I hope to continue to do the Broadway thing.
The Broadway thing's great.
It's the greatest thing, yeah.
So what are the coolest parts about being in multiple Broadway shows over your career?
You know, if you're a fan of Broadway and if you set out to do theater, it's like a storied community to be a part of, and also to go into these theaters. We just lost Carol Channing,
yeah.
who performed Hello Dolly for 7 years at the St. James Theater, and I played the St. James Theater as well, and to know that you know, walked the same boards as somebody like that is so extraordinary, and you know, it feels like such a giant. I remember when I made my Broadway debut, I did Grease on Broadway in 2008. And, you know, the character like came out of a hole, and I struck a pose. And I remember I was supposed to be doing something really, I was playing Marty, and I was supposed to be super confident. I was just crying because you're making your Broadway debut. There's nothing like that. It's the absolute mountaintop. For, you know, a nerd like me who's loved it forever. And it's just something I'll never forget, having those experiences. And having gone to see The Producers at 16 with my dad,
right.
I worked with Susan Stroman on Bullets Over Broadway. My dad sat in the second row of the mezzanine, and essentially exactly where we sat to see The Producers. And, you know, you can have these moments that feel like full circle moments as an actor.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, again, it's amazing. Some of the most incredible people I know are through the theater.
It's a beautiful story.
Yeah.
So you mentioned Carol Channing. Who are some other people that have inspired you over the years in terms of theater, TV,
Well,
comedy?
As I mentioned, Sutton Foster, who I will never meet because I'm so nervous.
You can't do it.
I can't
off
do
the
it.
Table.
We also lost an incredible friend and performer this year in Maren Mazie.
Mm-hmm.
Which is devastating, and she was somebody I saw in Kiss Me, Kate in 1999, who was a giant to me and still is a giant to me, and getting to work with her on Bullets Over Broadway, I learned so much from her, and I, you know, hope to continue to use what I learned from her for years to come. Brooks Ashmanskas is in The Prom right now on Broadway,
yep.
and I can't recommend going to see that enough. He's the funniest person I've ever met. But, you know, getting to be in that kind of space, and again, to throw a ball back and forth
right.
with somebody that you've known and admired for so long is such a blessing.
Yeah, it's a cool thing.
Yeah.
So you're doing the theater thing for a long time. How does TV first come into the picture, and the movies as well?
It's actually really funny. So the character I play in the other two stops dancing because she broke her ankle.
Was that you?
I broke my ankle doing a show and sort of thought, okay.
How do I pivot?
I was learning how to do a backflip for a musical, and it turns out I don't know how to do a backflip.
Safe to say you don't know.
I haven't attempted it since. It seems
probably
wise
good,
not to
idea.
Try again.
Yeah.
It turns out they're hard.
Yes.
Which, shocking. But I got hurt,
okay.
and I was in a cast on my right foot, and I showed up to LA, and it was pilot season, and my mom had to drive me around in the family van because I couldn't press a gas pedal with my like fiberglass casted leg. And I was like, I'm going to try to do TV. And, you know, went around and, you know, got handicap passes to hobble around the lots, and sort of started making my way. And, you know, it's tough. It's such a different medium to adjust to. From theater, you're filling a giant space, and from television, you're just talking to somebody directly across
right.
from you. So making that transition was something that was an adjustment. But again, just to tie it back into the other two, is what I think is so awesome is that you sort of think that your life is going to be linear, that you're going to sort of go like this, but you hit all these bumps, and it's how do you then take that bump and say, okay, I got hurt. What do I do next? Like, how do I continue to move forward? How do I use this? How does this become a part of my story in a positive way as opposed to a setback?
Definitely. We were talking off camera. You know, you never know how people are going to react to your shows, to your movies, right?
Yep.
So, like, for example, The Other Two is getting great reviews right now, but you've been on stuff that hasn't gotten good reviews, that has gotten good reviews, that hasn't lasted.
I opened a show, and I got in the car after the party, and I was like, I'm terrific in this. I'm so proud of myself. And I got in there. I was like, you know what? I'm going to read the review.
Mm.
And I went in, and they didn't. It was not positive.
They weren't feeling it.
And you just think, oh my God. And so again, that's another thing where you kind of get jolted and you think, no, I'm going to keep going forward. And, you know, to keep that forward motion and to stay like, I know what I'm doing, and I think I have a good voice, and I'm going to keep pushing at it. And so what's cool now is that people seem to be really loving the show. And, you know, so you just get to ride a wave now, and I hope people like the whole season.
Definitely. So when people check it out next week, what are the big things you want them to take away?
I want them to take away that, you know, I think that being able to sit down and laugh is, and, you know, without expectation,
right.
That's what I hope people get from it. You know, I binge watched Sharp Objects, I think, in 2 days.
Oh, wow.
And it was an extraordinary journey that I went on with Amy Adams. But it's a hard thing to watch.
Yeah.
And so it's nice to have something else now that, you know.
A little bit lighter.
A little bit lighter that sets you on a new way.
Yeah.
But also, I think people, especially us late millennials, you know, there's a lot of what we, I think you'll see yourselves in this.
Right.
And find comfort in none of us have it figured out.
We're all just trying to figure it out.
We're all just trying to figure it out and constantly kind of failing at it.
Helena York, succeeding and failing. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, DJ.
You can catch the other two on Comedy Central January 24th. We'll see you next time. You're on The Sit Down.